Very good morning and welcome to today's session on BIC Streams in collaboration with the Nature Conservation Foundation, NCF, Balcony Birding. What better way to spend a lockdown Sunday than trying to identify birds that we have all become newly aware of, again, thanks to the lockdown. We have with us today Garima Bhatia, avid bird watcher and naturalist. Thank you so much for doing this for us, Garima. Before I hand over to Garima, who will talk about early bird and explain the format of today's session, for those of you who are here for the first time and want to get updates from us, you can do so by visiting our website, bangaloreinternationalcenter.org, and you can also sign up to our social media channels, Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter. Welcome everyone, and over to you, Garima.
Thank you so much, Raghu, and I would like to thank BIC for this wonderful opportunity to reach out to people and to introduce newcomers to something that I'm very passionate about, which is watching birds and nature. So a little bit about Early Bird. We are a non-profit initiative of Nature Conservation Foundation. We create materials and resources to introduce children and beginner bird watchers to birds and nature. And a lot of our resources are available for free download through our website. So in today's session, I'm going to talk about common birds that we can see around us. Let me just share my screen. So in this lockdown, especially, all of us have become aware of birds, and we've started noticing nature around us. So what I'm going to do in today's session is take you through some of these birds that you can learn to identify and share with you some resources which you can use to get more familiar with birds. And as you get more interested, you can refer to these resources to enhance your skills. So India is home to a remarkable variety of birds, and that's due to the variety of habitats that we have in our country, from dry deserts to deep oceans, from tropical rainforest to the highest mountains. And whichever habitat you think of, there are always birds to be found there. In fact, all of us have grown up hearing stories of birds right from our childhood. In fact, our mythology and our culture is full of references to birds as well. The Bible has references to birds, the Quran does, and in Hindu mythology, in the Ramayana, Jatayu, who rescued Sita, was certainly a vulture, as you can see in the painting on the left. And in fact, if you look at a lot of literature from decades ago, you'll find that vultures were widespread across India. Now they are not so common, and in fact, they're seriously endangered. So we don't see them as often. There are a number of birds in our culture. The photograph on the left shows a pair of sarus cranes, which are birds that are found in agricultural fields across North India. And they are a symbol of love and fidelity for the simple reason that these birds mate for life. So the pair that's formed is for life. The bird on the right is a hornbill. This particular species is a great hornbill, but we find many species of hornbills in India. And hornbills are what I like to call lockdown specialists because they have this unique breeding behavior wherein the female enters a tree hollow that the pair have excavated. And then the female gets sealed inside this hollow. Both the male and the female seal the hollow with a combination of mud and their own feces, and leaving only a very tiny slit. And through this slit, for the next several weeks and sometimes months, the male hornbill feeds the female by bringing fruits and berries and insects and passing them through the slit. So the female remains locked down inside this tree hollow until the eggs hatch and the fledglings become big enough to fend for themselves, at which point the pair breaks down the seal and the female emerges after an extended lockdown. So in this lockdown period, when we feel frustrated at not being able to go out of our homes, spare a thought for the female hornbill sitting inside in a hole just barely bigger than the size of her body. Hornbills are mentioned in the folklore of Northeast India, because that's where they occur, and also in the Western Ghats. So what we'll do is we'll play a small quiz. And through this talk, I hope to make it a little interactive through these quizzes. And I'll also share with you some of the sounds of birds, etc. So the first question in the quiz, which is the smallest bird in India? And the options are bee hummingbird, flower pecker, sunbird, and sparrow. I'll give you a few seconds to think over it before I reveal the answer. So I see that most of you have replied bee hummingbird, and that is not the correct answer. The correct answer is flower pecker. In fact, we don't have hummingbirds in India at all. So the smallest bird in India is a species of birds called flower peckers. And there's one particular bird belonging to this family called the pale-billed flower pecker, which can be heard very often in South India and in Bangalore, where I live. In this picture, it's eating a fruit from the Singapore cherry tree, which is a tree that it really loves. So if you have one of those trees in your backyard, keep your eyes open and your ears open for this bird. I'll play the call of this bird so you know what to hear. And when you hear this, you'll know that this bird is around. So that tick, 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 tick sound that you hear, that's the call of the pale-billed flower pecker. It's a very small bird, 8 centimeters in size and weighs just a few grams. And the smallest bird in the world is the bee hummingbird. And this is 5 centimeters, and that's the photo on the right. I'll go to the next question. Which bird was in contention for the national bird of India, but eventually lost out to Indian peafowl? The options are red jungle fowl, Himalayan monal, great Indian bustard, and satyr tragopan. I see that most of you have replied great Indian bustard, and that in fact is the correct answer. This is what this bird looks like. It's found in arid areas and it's found in some very small pockets in Rajasthan, Maharashtra, Gujarat, and also Karnataka. It's critically endangered. There are just around 300 individuals left in the wild. It's endangered due to loss of habitat. And there are conservation efforts underway to protect the species. And incidentally, the reason that this bird lost out to the Indian peafowl was because of its name, which is prone to an unfortunate mispronunciation. So why do we watch birds? Birds really are wonderful as a window to nature. And when we watch birds, it gives us a sense of joy and peace. And we also pick up skills like focus and observation. And in fact, there are studies that have shown that children who get exposed to nature from a young age do better in terms of their cognitive abilities, and they are able to perform better even in other subjects. So there are a lot of intangible benefits from being exposed to nature. Birds also excite our curiosity. We wonder where they live, what they eat. They excite our imagination. They excite our inspiration. They provide inspiration as well, because they perform often remarkable feats of migration. You may know that there are birds which actually fly as high as the Himalayas, and very tiny birds that fly thousands of kilometers, some birds that fly nonstop. So these are really remarkable feats that inspire us in many ways. And once we start caring about birds, we want to make efforts to conserve them. But the point is, should we make efforts to conserve them? Are birds worth saving? So the answer is yes, because they provide a number of important ecological functions. Insect-eating birds help with pest control. The nectar-feeding birds help with pollination of flowers. And fruit-eating birds help with seed dispersal. In fact, hornbills are sometimes referred to as farmers of the forest because of the way in which they disperse, or they help to disperse, the seeds of the fruit that they've eaten, thereby helping to grow the forest. But the main reason to watch birds really is because they are beautiful and colorful. They make wonderful sounds. They are accessible. So they are really everywhere and all around us. And unlike other wildlife, like tigers or leopards, where you need to go to a jungle or on a safari to really get a glimpse of those animals, birds, on the other hand, are all around us. And we don't need to go anywhere. We can watch them from our homes. We just need to become aware that they are around. They're also interesting in many ways. So birds sing and dance, they court their partners, they build nests and homes, they care for their young, and in many ways they are just like us. So no wonder that bird watchers are a growing tribe, and bird watching is one of the most fulfilling and satisfying hobbies that you could pick up. There's a quote that I'll share with you that I really like, which says, "Bird watching is your lifetime ticket to the theater of nature." And this is so true, because the birds that are around us are inherently wildlife, and they are wild things, and we can watch them as they go about their business. So now I'll take you through some of the common Indian birds that are found in cities across India. Bird watchers learn to identify birds visually as well as by their sounds. In fact, most of the time, we don't often see the bird. We hear the bird, and then we realize that there is a bird around, and then we probably will see it. So it's really rewarding to get familiarized with the calls, especially of the common birds around us. Recently there was an article which mentioned that being able to identify birds by their calls is like the closest thing that we can get to having a superpower. And that's so true, because if you met a bird watcher, or if you are a bird watcher, you'll know that you can never really turn off your bird watching. So sometimes it happens, I'm in the middle of a conversation and I hear a bird in my background, and I know, this is what it is. And the person I'm talking to gets quite impressed. Oh, how did you know that? But it's really simple. Once you get familiar, you learn to tune yourself to the calls of those birds. So let's go through some of these common birds and their calls. This is a familiar bird that's seen in our cities and towns. It's called the common mynah. And they are usually found in flocks, very noisy flocks, and they have these very smart yellow goggles around the eyes. This is what the common mynah sounds like. So that was the common mynah, and you can often see them feeding on kitchen scraps or, you know, just generally making a ruckus in the neighborhood. Mynahs are part of a family of birds called starlings. And on this slide, there are four different types that I've shown. So the jungle mynah on the left, despite its name, is actually seen quite often in cities, both the jungle and the common mynah. And you can learn to identify them because of the fact that the jungle mynah doesn't have those yellow goggles. The Asian pied starling on the top right is a common variety of starling that's found in northern and eastern India, not found in South India. On the bottom left is a Brahmini starling. These are birds found across India, but not so much in cities. You'll usually see them in wooded areas, or if you go to the outskirts of a city, you might find them. The bird on the bottom right is called a rosy starling. And this is one of the migratory species of starlings that come to India. And we are fortunate to see this bird in many parts of India. And if you've seen videos of huge flocks of birds flying in different formations and wondered that, you know, these look like bees almost. There are so many birds. Those are called murmurations, and they're quite a sight to watch. So if you're lucky enough to see one of those spectacles, you'll know that these are flocks of rosy starlings. Another familiar bird is the house crow. This is actually a very intelligent bird. And we've grown up hearing stories of crows, and crows can actually use tools. They've been known to use tools to access food and water. And they've also learned to recognize faces. And that may be perhaps the reason why crows have such a special place in our rituals and our culture and our beliefs. Crows are scavengers, so they're seen around human habitation. And here's what a house crow sounds like. This is, of course, a very familiar call to all of us. But there are actually two varieties of crows that are common in cities. So the house crow is one, and the other is called a large billed or a jungle crow, which is completely black, but looks similar otherwise. The most common bird of prey that we see in our cities is this one. It's called a black kite, although you can see that it's actually brown in color, but it's called a black kite. And it's often mistaken for an eagle. But usually the birds that we see in the cities are kites. And when you go to forests, you're much likely to see eagles, or if you go to the outskirts of a city. Kites are also scavengers like crows. Sometimes if there's a garbage dump, you'll see huge flocks of black kites circling around. And here's what it sounds like. So it sounds a little bit like a horse, in my opinion. But this is one trick that bird watchers use to remember the sounds of birds. So when you hear a bird, think of what it reminds you of and make an association to that sound. You can also think of mnemonics that will help you remember the sounds of birds. And I'll mention one of those later in the call, in the talk. This bird is called a rose-ringed parakeet. many people think that these are parrots. They are actually of the parrot family. But the true parrots are the ones that are found in South America, which are much larger and very colorful. The parrot family that we have in India are all called parakeets. And these are also often seen in noisy flocks, screeching as they fly over our houses and gardens. These birds are also often illegally caged and sold as pets. Perhaps some of us might have grown up with a parakeet as a pet inside a cage. But since the Wildlife Protection Act came into place, trading and selling of any species that's found in the wild in India is now considered illegal. So this is what the parakeet sounds like. And these birds actually even learn to mimic humans sometimes, which is why they're popular as cage birds. Another bird that would be very familiar to those of us who live in Bangalore is this one. It's called the white-cheeked barbet. And in the months of March and April, you can't go long without hearing this bird. It's very, very vocal. This is what it sounds like. So it has this very distinctive kutru kutru kind of call. And this bird is endemic to peninsular India. So that means that it's found only in this part of the world and nowhere else in the world. And barbets, like woodpeckers and hornbills, also nest in tree holes. These are some of the other varieties of barbets found in India. On the top left is a coppersmith barbet. It's a very small but very colorful and beautiful bird. And you can see in this picture how it's actually blending into the background. You can, if you have a fruiting ficus tree, you're likely to find some coppersmith barbets there. On the right is a brown-headed barbet, which is more common in northern India and parts of India where the white-cheeked is not found. The bottom two barbets shown here are found in the Himalayas. And in fact, the one on the bottom right, the blue-throated, is found not only in the Himalayas, but also in a city, that's Calcutta. So if you go to Calcutta, you will most likely see blue-throated barbets, even in crowded areas. Another thing I wanted to mention was about the silhouettes of these birds. So initially, when you start looking at birds, it's useful to learn to identify groups of birds or families of birds. It doesn't matter if you can't remember the exact name, but it's helpful to remember what a crow might look like versus a barbet or a parakeet. And for that, if you look at the silhouette, there are certain things that you can remember, like parakeets have a long tail, barbets have a thick, heavy bill, and so on. Here's one bird that's a kingfisher, but it's often found away from water. And this is a white-throated kingfisher, and it has adapted to feed on lizards and insects, and even small birds. So this sometimes is quite common, even in the city areas away from water. And this is what it sounds like. There are several varieties of kingfishers again in India. The pied, stock-billed, and the common kingfisher are found across India, whereas the crested kingfisher is found only in the Himalayas. And kingfishers, interestingly, can eat up to their own body weight in fish every day. Another common bird of our cities is the common tailor bird. This is a very tiny bird, but very, very vocal. So you would certainly know the call of this bird. It's called a tailor bird because it stitches its nest together using leaves. And of course, it doesn't have a needle to stitch, but it uses its beak and its claws to stitch this nest together. And this bird actually finds mention in one of the books by Rudyard Kipling, where there's a character called Darzi, which is a common tailor bird. Here's the call of the common tailor bird. So you can see it's a very loud call and it continuously keeps calling. So you won't miss it if there's a tailor bird near your home. Bulbuls are another common species that are found in cities. This is the red-vented bulbul. This is actually a common garden bird, but it's found in areas that are drier than its cousin, the red whiskered bulbul, which is on the next slide. I'll play the call of this one for you first. So one common mnemonic that's used for the call of this bird is brief review. And apparently the call reminds you of that. So you can use that to remember what this bird sounds like. And its close cousin, the red-whiskered bulbul, has this jaunty crest on its head. In fact, most bulbuls have a crest. And so that's how you can tell that this bird belongs to the bulbul family. And the mnemonic of this one is pleased to meet you. And you can hear the call and see if it sounds like that. So that was the red-whiskered bulbul. Here's the Asian koel, and this is the male Asian koel, which looks very much like a crow. But in this season, the koels are singing all over the place. So I'll play the call, and you would certainly have heard this bird sometime. Sorry. So that's a very familiar call to most of us. And this bird usually calls at dawn and dusk. And this is the female koel, which looks quite different from the male. And interestingly, the female and the male have different calls in this species. And I'll just play this one. That was the call of the female. So the singing coo, coo that we usually hear, koels belong to the cuckoo family and they are what we call brood parasites. So they don't actually build their nest, but they lay their eggs in the nest of other birds, usually crows.
Garima, we just lost you there. If you can okay. Just, yeah.
Sure. So should I play the call once again?
Ravi, are you there? Okay, you can just play it again, yeah.
Yeah. So here's what the call of the koel, the female koel sounds like. So that was the female koel. And usually the familiar koel call, coo, coo, the singing call that we hear, That's the male koel singing. Koels belong to the cuckoo family, and they are brood parasites, which means that they don't build their own nest, but they lay their eggs in the nest of another species, usually crows. Here's what we have in India. I mentioned earlier that we don't have hummingbirds in India, but we have sunbirds, which are somewhat similar because they show a similar behavior of hovering in front of flowers, and they feed on nectar. These are also garden birds, and sometimes they cheat. Usually when they feed on nectar, they also help in pollinating the flowers, but sometimes they cheat the flower and they poke their beak through the base of the flowers to get at the nectar. Here's what the call of the purple-rumped sunbird sounds like. So this is the male purple-rumped sunbird, but the females are dull-colored usually, and the two birds on the left are the females of purple-rumped and purple sunbird species, and on the right are the bottom right is the male of the purple sunbird, which is common in cities across India, and the top right is a male green-tailed sunbird, which is a beautiful sunbird found in the Himalayas. In fact, there are several varieties of very colorful sunbirds that we can see in the Himalayas. A comment on the fact that male birds usually are more colorful than females. The reason is that the male birds are colorful to attract the female, of course, but usually it's the female which performs the duties of incubating the eggs once they are laid. So the female has a greater need for camouflage, and that's why the female is dull colored. But there are certain species of birds in which the roles are reversed. So actually the male takes care of the eggs, incubates and takes care of the chicks, while the female just lays the eggs and moves away. In those species, it's the female that's brightly colored and the male that's dull colored. So again, there's an evolutionary reason for that. And finally, here's one bird that we don't see as much in our modern cities as perhaps we used to earlier, the house sparrow. The male on the left and the female on the right. But they're still quite common in towns and rural areas. And in fact, there have been studies recently showing that the overall population of house sparrows has been quite stable. They are not actually in decline, although in certain pockets in the cities, they may be hard to find. Here's the call of the house sparrow. So we'll get back to our quiz now, now that we know some of the familiar species that are found in cities. Let's learn a little more about birds in general. So the third question, birds are the closest living relatives of dinosaurs, true or false? This is a fairly simple question. And I see that most of you have got it right. It is actually true that birds are the closest living relatives of dinosaurs. And you can look this up online. It's just fascinating. I know many kids who are absolutely hooked to dinosaurs and know all kinds of things about them. So it's really cool that actually birds are descendants of dinosaurs, and in particular of a meat-eating variety of dinosaurs called theropods. And we all know about the famous fossil of Archaeopteryx, which is supposed to be the first bird So the next question, birds see the world in black and white, true or false? So I see that most of you have got this right. It's false. Birds actually have excellent eyesight, much superior to humans, in fact. And a cool fact is that birds can see ultraviolet light. So that means they see more colors than us, and they see brighter colors than us. So you can see that a bird that looks black to us might look very different from a bird's point of view. The next question, all birds have feathers, true or false? So this one, I see that it's split 50-50. It's actually true that all birds have feathers. Though we know that not all birds can fly, but all birds do have feathers, because flight is just one of the functions that feathers serve. There are other functions like waterproofing and insulation that's provided by feathers. An important function is that of display, where usually the male of the species is very brightly colored and does various displays to attract the female. They also serve the function of camouflage. So dull colored birds need to hide from predators. And so if you go to a desert, for instance, you'll find that the birds are sand colored there. You won't find very brightly colored birds in the desert. There's this tutorial that you can refer to. It's from Cornell Lab of Ornithology, and it's really cool. It talks about various kinds of feathers and how feathers are actually quite remarkable feats of engineering. So we'll share all these links with you in the chat box and in the description, so you can refer to them later. The next question, why do birds call or sing? Options, to attract a mate, to establish territory, to warn against a predator, or all of the above. And this is an easy one. I see that most of you have got it right. The answer is all of the above. So birds sing to attract their mates and announce their territories. They call in alarm or to announce food. And every species of bird has its own unique song and call. And I want to play the call of this bird, which is one of our most remarkable songsters that we have in India. It's a bird called the Malabar Whistling Thrush. And it's an endemic, so it's found only in the Western Ghats and nowhere else in the world. And it's nicknamed the Whistling Schoolboy. I'll play its call and you'll know why. So if you've ever been on a holiday in Coorg, for instance, and woken up in the morning wondering who is singing at that early hour, it's possible that it might have been a bird, and this one, the Whistling Schoolboy. Question number 7, all birds build nests, true or false? And this should be easy because we already talked about this. Okay, I see that most of you have got it right. It's false. There are many varieties of birds that don't build nests. Of course, we talked about the brood parasites. And in this photo, you can see a young quail that's begging to be fed by its foster parent. That's a house crow. But there are also birds which are ground nesters, and they don't build nests, but they lay their eggs in just a scrape on the ground. And this is one such bird. It's called a red-wattled lapwing. And this has a very interesting call as well. This bird sounds like, did he do it? Did he do it? In several Indian languages, its name comes from the call. So for example, in Marathi, this bird is called Titui, which is what the call sounds like. Next question. Which of the following features of birds help them to fly? Options: no liver or kidneys, zero body fat, no bones, only cartilage, hollow bones. Which of these are helpful for birds to enable them to fly? And I see that most of you got it right. The correct answer is hollow bones. So flight is one of the most fascinating aspects of birds. And there are a number of adaptations that birds have which enable them to fly. They're very light, their bones are hollow. The shape of their wings is streamlined for flight. And in fact, physics can be taught by studying how birds fly. And of course, our modern aircraft have been inspired by the design of the bodies of birds. They also have several other adaptations which enable them to fly and to maneuver and change direction. Next question, which of the following is missing in birds? Options are toes, teeth, spine, or ears. And most of you have indeed picked the right answer. It's teeth. Birds don't have teeth. Again, because teeth are heavy and birds need to be light to be able to fly. But the question arises then, if they don't have teeth, they swallow everything whole. So how do they manage to digest their food? And sometimes we would have seen maybe a kingfisher or a pelican swallowing an entire fish, or even birds of prey swallowing their prey whole. How do they manage to digest it? So the reason, the way they do it is they have two parts to their stomach. They have a gizzard which grinds up the food. And that in fact provides the same functionality that teeth provide for humans. And then the true stomach digests the food. And then later, the undigestible portions of what they've eaten, like the hard shell of beetles, etc., these get regurgitated by the bird in a pellet form through the mouth. And scientists who study birds, and for example, birds of prey and owls, they often collect owl pellets and analyze them to discover what the bird had eaten. And the last question, identify this bird from the call. And this is a call that we heard during the presentation, so you should know what it is. So yes, most of you got this right. It is in fact the white-cheeked barbet. And here's a picture of the white-cheeked barbet. So now that you're familiar with the calls of several common species of birds, here are some digital materials that you can refer to. And these you can refer to from the comfort of your home. We have a variety of different resources available on our website, from flashcards and pocket guides to different regions, to posters that you can print out and display in your home. You can also go online to the website of Cornell Lab of Ornithology, where they have a number of interesting games that you can play online about different aspects of birds. From Early Bird, we also have a number of YouTube videos available These are webinars that we've been conducting over the past several months. These are available in 5 different languages, and starting from introductory and going up to different aspects of birds. There are also apps now for everything. So there are apps that you can refer to. Merlin is one app where you can browse through photos and facts of birds found in India and across the world. And you can also use it to identify a bird that you've clicked a photo of and you don't know what that bird is. There's also another app called Vanya that you can refer to. There's an interesting app called iNaturalist, which is not just related to birds, but any living thing. You can take photos of spiders, insects, butterflies, plants, flowers, and upload them. And the app will give you suggestions as to what that species is. And there's a community of users who will also help you out in identification. Of course, digital is one thing, but there's nothing quite like the experience of going out and watching birds. And during the lockdown, of course, you know, do watch birds from your home. But once you're able to go out, it can be very rewarding to just go to a lake or a wetland near your home, find a quiet place to sit and watch birds there. You can start a nature journal with some simple sketches. And one of our webinars on early bird has been about sketching birds as well. So you can refer to that on our YouTube channel. And then once you become familiar with the birds, you can start maintaining a list of birds either in your notebook or later on, once you become familiar and you really know what birds you're looking at, you can register on this website called eBird. eBird.org, and there's an app as well. So you can use the app to record the birds that you've seen on your walk or at a lake near you or at a park or garden. And then, of course, there are a number of books that are available that you can refer to. There are books for beginners, for children. There are field guides which describe all the different species of birds found in India, either through photographs or through illustrations. And these are some of the popular books that are available. So with that, I come to the end of my talk. And please do feel free to reach out to me or my colleagues at Early Bird through our website and through our social media profiles. We'll be happy to answer any questions that you may have or refer you to resources that you can use to enhance your knowledge of birds. Happy birding, and that's all from me. Thank you.